So we've had lots of races there.
Well, we have families.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, people of all ages. It is Tuesday, April 9th at 4:00 PM. I'll call the Community Safety Electronic Meeting to order. We have minutes from last month. Can I have a motion on the minutes? All in favor? Thank you. We have an agenda, any additions or deletions? Nope. Next council meeting date is May 14th at 4:00 PM, right here. Be here or be nowhere. And Community Safety, Community Bylaws Monthly Activity Report, February 2024.
Who had the 9 ounces?
Mr. Carrato.
It's okay.
To the chair, just have a brief update on a ongoing bylaw file. This is in relation to 5,540 number 6 road. Previously, we had provided an update to committee that this file was in long-form court provincial proceedings, that we did originally have a positive ruling, and then we were awaiting the judgment. The judgment came down for a total fine of $100,000 against 5 companies and 2 individuals. And I have nothing further to add and open to questions.
Thank you. Councillor Galanders.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the update. Westminster Highway going to be going down a similar path, do you think?
Through the chair to Councillor Galanders, if we are not able to obtain compliance through our current course of ticketing, then that may end up in long form prosecution or a combination thereof of Supreme Court action. It's something that we would weigh our decision-making with city law as well to determine our next steps.
Okay, thank you. Through the chair, do they have a similar sort of attitude of entitlement that the other property has, or are they more working towards a solution to get out of there?
Through the chair to Councillor Galanders, perhaps further discussion on that particular file could be done and closed.
Sure. Okay, I have another. Oh, that's on the next report. But thank you for the report and good job.
Councillor Heed.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The entitlement attitude certainly is something we have to address here. And, you know, we can't be pushed around, we can't be bullied. So my hat's off to you for being assertive, not aggressive, but assertive on making sure we have compliance with the laws that we have control over as a municipal government. So certainly I appreciate your efforts. If you could give me an update, and I think this is the appropriate time versus a management report, on number one is Beijing Palace, and number two would be Tokyo Health Products.
Through the chair to Councillor Heed, on regarding Beijing Mansion, staff took enforcement action, tickets were issued. Thus far, we haven't seen a continuing operation of a business at that location. There is ongoing issues that need to be resolved regarding outstanding permits, regarding construction without a permit. And we are working with the building department and the owner to resolve those issues. Regarding Tokyo Beauty, staff, bylaw staff and city law are preparing for some imminent steps. Perhaps we could provide that update in closed as well.
I just want to ensure that these are things, these are examples that we have to set if we're going to be serious as a local government in dealing with some of the ongoing issues within our community. Thank you.
Councillor Hobbs.
Thanks, and through the chair. Thank you for the report. Just a couple of quick questions. One, on page 11, when we're talking about noise, would that include things like construction noise that is occurring in neighborhoods? And the traffic tickets wouldn't be for noise, but and also perhaps other bylaw tickets to do with parking and congestion that we have in some neighborhoods, because that can be really tough on the people living there. So, A, does that include that type of thing?
Through the chair to Councillor Hobbs, yes, it does. It includes construction-related noise and noise regarding construction outside of permitted hours, construction noise in excess of the allowable limits, and regarding parking, staff will enforce the good neighbor policy and all of those provisions. I would note that a lot of the increase in the noise-related calls for service were related to mechanical-type devices. So included in the panoply of different noise-related matters is construction, but also mechanical devices such as heat pumps that exceed the allowable limit of
okay,
noise.
Okay. And just one other or two other quick things. Just in relation to that, the traffic and the noise, we did have, a public discussion about Spires Road in particular. Is there any update on that, or do you have a sense that you can just talk about how that's going, improvements in that?
Through the chair to Councillor Hobbs, staff did reach out to a couple of concerned citizens and did conduct some proactive patrols. Also working with Public Works Department as well to address some issues as well regarding drainage ditches. The last update I received is that it was progressing positively. I am not aware of any current active complaints regarding construction activity in the area.
Yeah, neither am I. Actually, I've heard a couple of positive comments from people, so maybe the same people. And lastly, just on page 16, I just want to confirm something. When you're looking at table 4 and the fines and the 410 in fines, is that strictly for unlicensed dogs or is that something else as well?
Fines for
410 one in particular, I'm just wondering what that was. It's in the bottom table, table 4.
Yes, so through the chair to Councillor Hobbs, I can provide a breakdown of what the fines are. Typically, fines are for dogs that are off leash or people who have had lapses in their license and they haven't paid. So typically, when we do see license-related fines and we do enforce, we tend to get compliance with them then seeking their license either. So it is something that is a positive in terms of revenue as well.
Thanks a lot.
Councillor Day.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Thank you for the report. Organized as always, Mr. Cordato. Previously, I sent staff some photos and addresses of residential homes in residential areas that had storage containers for long, long, long periods of times and were in fact used as storage and even had storage written on the side of them. Where are we at with those?
Through the chair to Councillor Day, staff opened up investigations on all of those particular files. Some have come into compliance, others have not, and they're under investigation.
Okay. Do we have a policy? Because I believe there was something about if you had a storage container, it could only be for like a demo period, that kind of thing?
Through the chair to Councillor Day, I believe you require a permit for such a storage container if it's construction related.
Yeah, but they can't have it there for like a year.
Through the chair to Councillor Day, it wouldn't be permitted use.
Yeah, okay, thank you very much.
We have a question from Councillor Wolf online.
Thank you very much, through the chair to staff. Two questions, both are related to details on page CS13. The first one is at the very top, it talks about signage calls, and it's been probably close to 6 months now that much of East Richmond has been littered with signs on the side of the road, just like beside the ditch, beside the road, and they're in the shape of like a throwing star or a wheel with four spikes, and it's the garage door ninja. Many of the signs, the writing is actually washed off and is now in the waterway and stuff. I think that was the month where I saw a number of them go down off the side of the road. There's still a lot around the Department of National Defense land, which I know is not all city land, but I think the edge is on this side of the ditch. So I'm just curious, has that company been contacted by bylaws in relation to their inappropriate sign placement?
Through the chair to Councillor Wolf, I can provide an update to you on that. I don't have that information at my ready right now.
Okay, thanks. My second question to the chair. On that same page under soil activity, we're now up to the city's working on addressing 34 properties that are non-compliant. Of the ones that were added in February, I'm familiar with East Richmond Roads. Five of these, when I look at them, they were a bit surprising. Like there's houses that look like people live in them in the front. So what would be, is there any trend in what new types of properties were being added in February? Are they soil removal or dumping on soil?
Through the chair to Councillor Wolf, the trend continues that the majority of our soil-related calls are for soil deposition without unauthorized soil deposition. And then usually there's a corollary where they would have to remove that soil. But originally the issue is they were depositing soil without necessary permits.
Okay, much appreciated. Thank you very much.
Councillor Heed, do you have another question?
Yes, Madam Chair, thank you. And it's just Councillor Hobbs asked, and I just need clarification on the fines part, Mr. Corrado. Are our bylaw officers issuing fines for dog-related, such as off-leash, various things like that, or are we exclusively leaving that for the SPCA?
Through the chair to Councillor Heed, the data that's collected there reflects the fines that are issued by the SPCA contract service provider.
It's included in this figure?
Through the chair to Councillor Heed, yes, that's correct.
Thank you. Just a follow-up. So our bylaw officers still have the authority to issue bylaw offense infractions with off-leash?
Through the chair to Councillor Heed, yes, that's correct. Any city employee that's covered under the definition of a bylaw enforcement officer under the bylaw enforcement bylaw can issue those tickets, and also SPCA is included also under that bylaw to be able to issue tickets as well with the authority from council.
Thank you.
We have a motion.
So moved.
All in favor? Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Corrado. Richmond Fire Rescue Monthly Activity Report, February. Deputy Fire Chief Al McGrath.
Hello, everyone. As the chair said, I'm Alan McGrath, acting for Fire Chief Wishlove. I have nothing to add to the report, but open for questions.
Councillor Galanders.
Thank you, through the chair. To you, thanks for filling in, and good report. CS20, I just want to highlight the value preserved from damage for fire and property losses. That value preserved was $15,394,311.99%. Of the value of the properties were saved, and so just to really appreciate that, as always. And then I'm just curious about the incident of explosion. That's unusual. It doesn't seem to be ever in our average, and it hasn't happened before. Did you want to elaborate on what the explosion was?
Yeah, through the chair to Councillor Galanders, I will. It was a residential. Some new tenants moved into Terra Nova. They had a gas fireplace. It had a ruptured line. They didn't know it was flowing in the night. The pilot light ignited it. They had an explosion. It put the fire out itself, so our crews responded to that.
They put it out themselves?
No, the explosion put the fire out itself.
And nobody was injured?
No injuries.
Oh, but that's good.
It had the potential to be much more serious.
Wow. Okay, thank you.
Councillor Heath?
Yes, thank you. Chief, just related to the overdose figures, and you know, I certainly appreciate how your agency divides it up. The ones, and I asked this of Mr. Wishlove last time, the ones that your resources respond to, I'm not sure what his answer was, but do we administer Narcan, or is there any way we can determine whether your resources are administering Narcan or EHS is administering the Narcan?
Through the chair to Councillor Heed, the only way we'd be able to do that is I'd just have to check what supplies are used on each call. So often our crews will administer naloxone, which is Narcan. Sometimes bystanders have already administered it. Sometimes BC Ambulance will administer it. Sometimes multiple groups administer it. So the only way to do that would be to check our reordering supplies on each call.
Could you do it through the duty report? I'm going back to maybe a long time ago where the lieutenant or the captain would do a duty report. Do they identify that in there? Could we retrieve that data?
Through the chair to Councillor Heed, we use FDM reporting. So the duty report, obviously electronic now, and it will say whether naloxone was administered or not by our crews. It might not say the amount.
Be nice if we could just extrapolate that information. And
so through the chair to Councillor Heed, just so I'm clear, are you asking related to the number of overdoses, say it's 9, how many times our crews have administered?
Correct. Yes. That's the one we have at least some control of versus EHS. Well, Coastal Health, I'm not even sure if they keep that particular data.
Yeah, through the chair to Councillor Heed, we would just keep our data. BC Ambulance would keep their data. I will take it back and just make sure I'm not opening any boxes I'm not allowed to open, and then I'll do my best to get back.
You just let me know if Jim has a problem. Thanks.
Councillor Day.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Well, thank you for the report. It's always detailed, and I appreciate the information. I see that in 2023, at this time, we had 490 overdoses, but now we're up to 540 overdoses in the same time period in just 1 year. And then I also note on page 24 that the actual those are medical calls for medical calls were 490 to 540, but the overdose calls went from 23 in February last year to 34 this year. That's an incredible increase. How are the teams handling that? And can you tell me how many deaths we've had so far this year?
Through the chair to Councillor Day, first of all, the overdoses have increased from February of last year. However, regionally, our increases are not significant.
Okay.
I will say that. The crews are managing it well, fine. They are administering more naloxone because the drugs are getting stronger, as you're all aware. And as far as medicals increase, I have nothing of significance to report.
And do you know how many deaths there have been from overdose in this year so far?
Through the chair to Councillor Day, I do not. I can only report what I hear in the media, which I'm sure you've heard recently as well.
Something
through the coroner.
Like 5, is it?
Yeah. Through the chair to Councillor Day, we don't keep those statistics because we're not legally allowed to pronounce people dead.
Oh, right, of course. I never thought. I mean, who as a first responder, as a firefighter, expected that they'd be dealing with such a significant amount of calls that are medical as opposed to fire-related? But I really want to say thanks for the chart on page 26. It really clearly shows the fire calls fairly steady, and then we've got the total medical calls have just spiked. So I'm glad that you're out there taking care of our citizens. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
Councillor Hobbs, even the cops.
Thank you, and through the chair. Just a couple quick clarifications, if you can. And on page 21, table 2 is one of the tables. When it's multifamily residential fires, there's 5. And I just wondered if you had any comment about the cause for that compared to, like, single-family homes, there were 0 in this reporting period. So is that typically in the kitchen area or something like that, or...?
Through the chair to Councillor Hobbs, in my experience, it's often a pot on a stove.
Right. Okay.
In multifamily, but that's just my own experience.
Well, that counts.
Yeah.
And the other question would be with the outdoor fires. I think there was 25, and you break it down later in the report, I think, on table 5, but some are suspicious. It's kind of in some ways, a strange time of year to have outdoor fires at all. So some are probably done for warming purposes for people. But is there anything else you can add to that? Were they all associated to, you know, essentially campfires or
Through the chair to Councillor Hobbs, I did run a 10-year report just in prep for this meeting, and outdoor fires have increased since 2015 each year. I could speculate that climate, the climate's warmer, we all know that, conditions are drier. We also have more people living outdoors.
Right, okay, thank you.
Councillor Galanders?
Thank you through the chair. I just had a couple more follow-up questions. On CS21, just a comment on the significant events, the medical event on Saba Road, that sounds really sad, and yes, there's no information about whether it was an accident or intentional, or whether or not we know that probably doesn't matter, but my condolences go out to the crews and any family or anybody that was affected by that. And then the hazardous materials on Westminster Highway, the hydrochloric acid, I was just wondering, was there an emergency, was there an environmental response as far as anything going into the drains or any environmental damage and mitigation?
Through the chair to Councillor Galanders, it was a cleaning product. It was a small volume, 4 liters, didn't get into the drains, so there was no environmental issues. We just diluted it as we would with any acid.
Okay, just a follow-up. Is there any criminal responsibility or any fines or anything that got associated with something like that, or if it's just an accident or was it negligence? Or
through the chair to Councillor Galanders, I don't have any specifics in regard to that.
That's a more of a enforcement. Okay, well, thank you very much.
We have a motion.
So move.
Second. All in favor? Thank you. Fire chief briefing.
To the chair, just we did receive an email from the BC Ambulance Supervisor, who we have a really good working relationship with, and it was a good news story. Their crews reported that they love working with Richmond crews. And what I mean by that is even as they use a dynamic staffing model, so we get crews coming in from Vancouver, Delta, Surrey regularly, and they don't all have great working relationships in those cities. So they actually are impressed with the Richmond crews, how professional, courteous we are. And I will add, we've had a good working relationship with BC Ambulance in Richmond, a unique working relationship with BC Ambulance for decades. So just wanted to pass that on.
Thank you. Any questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
Richmond RCMP Monthly Activity Report, February 2024. Chief Superintendent Dave Chauhan.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair. I have nothing to add to the report. I welcome any questions and comments anyone may have.
Councillor Heed.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mine is going to be related, more or less. I thought I'd bring it up here because it somewhat relates to your monthly report rather than just a briefing. And I guess my first thought is, we've had Narcan, also known as Naloxone, with your members for, I think it's about 3 or 4 years at this time. Do we have, keep any statistical data on the numbers of times they may have utilized it?
To the chair, to Councillor Heed, there is no official mechanism of tracking the deployment of Narcan. But our members are equipped with at least two units of Narcan if need to be deployed. But I don't believe there's a tracking mechanism. There are various reportings there, but it's my understanding that there's no, as the Deputy Chief mentioned earlier, Narcan can be deployed either by the individual or other groups or EHS or fire. But as far as the police is concerned, I don't believe that there's a official tracking of when a member deployed compared to if there's a taser or some other devices deployed that is subject to our reporting SBOR, subject behavior, the officer response reports.
I guess where I'm going on this is all good news stuff. And I think this is where we've got to really publicize something like this through the public. And you know, going back to my departments, and the largest being Vancouver, we hear nothing about it. But if a police officer administers Narcan that saves someone's life, I don't care if the person just gets up and runs away, like I've been there and that's happened, or they're admitted to a medical facility. The fact is that we've got our law enforcement professionals out there that are caring, and that they do. So I guess my encouragement is, if you're aware of any, there, or maybe your NCOs, if they could just let you know and let us know, because that's deserving of accolades, if that's in case, or that's a fact. And as you know, not everyone was enamored by the fact that police were going to have this. We had some pushback, but I think at the end of the day, it was the right thing to do. But I think the men and women that are out there, and when they do it, I think we've got to recognize them to a certain extent. And I guess I have a couple of reports, and the general manager of community safety also sent a report with respect to this ongoing drug prevention strategy that we talked about in the last meeting, and you and I had a separate conversation with respect to this. And Mr. Warzel has laid out certainly what's going on right now. And I think the intent of our discussion was to look at something in addition to everything that your organization is doing. I'm not confident that our school system can deliver what's required for the majority of our youth here in Richmond. And the point I wanted to make here, I think there's so many other areas that we can focus on that drug prevention, such as the community organizations and various other venues to get the message out to our community. You know, again, I think we focus too much on the schools, and we expect them to do it. I'm just not sure our school board's in tune with what's required. So I just wanted some comments on that. It's great what's going on, but as you know, we're always clamoring for more and more and more, and I think the will around, at least with some of the counselors here, is if we could come up with something creative for Richmond, that the support would be here at the council table. I'm hoping the support would be here at the council table for the resources for you to do this.
Through the chair to Councillor Heed, I think anything that we can do to promote and to educate our public when it comes to drug prevention, I am open to looking at those programs, and we'll definitely review, and obviously with this the report that's been prepared by Ed Warzel, any additional programs that we can implement, I'll definitely have a look at that.
And you know, we certainly would appreciate that, and maybe it's got to be something made specific for Richmond. I know with such a large organization like yourself, trying to do the policy change often is not as quick as we would like it, but if we can get something unique, even if it's a pilot program, because the credibility still lays with the police. You know, I'm not, and others around the table know, I'm not a fan of the DARE program, but I think the credibility on getting the message out to our community and our youth comes from the police, and I think that's going to be there as we go forward. So whatever you can come up with that's creative, if we had to run a pilot, if you need resources, we'll certainly look at that to support you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Councillor Hobbs.
Thanks, and through the chair, thank you for the report, Chief. Just a couple quick comments in the report. I think it's good to highlight for the public the couple good arrests you made, the one patrol arrest down by a Great Canadian with the stolen car with the female suspect on a Canada-wide warrant. That's a significant arrest. and also the arrest that was made in relation to the child luring that occurred in Steveston, and a lot of people heard about that. I don't know if you have any further comment on those two.
Sure, thank you, through the chair, to Councillor Hobbs. The kudos goes to the officer who was working in the early morning hours and recognized something suspicious, a suspicious vehicle, which resulted in a determination that the individual had a Canada-wide warrant. The report only has three lines, but it was a quite an interesting unfolding of events, which resulted in one individual being arrested for having a Canada-wide warrant issued by Corrections Canada. So it was a really good good work by our member, and in this instance, New West PD was engaged in some capacity as well, so that was really good. And with respect to the child luring, I know there was a significant safety concern from the community, and that individual was arrested and is still being held in custody, and there'll be more news to follow on that.
Good, yeah, good heads up work. Just a couple of quick questions. On page 33, it talks about auto theft. I just wondered if you had any insights into what's happening with auto theft in Richmond. Are those what I might call more common run-of-the-mill auto thefts, where they're taken a joyride, maybe used in a property crime or something? Or are those more high-end auto thefts where, you know, they get shipped out of country and put in a container and off somewhere else in the world?
Through the chair to Councillor Hobbs. We have heard and read the reports, what's happening in Ontario, especially in Peel region. You're having about 600 vehicles that are being stolen there in a month. We do not have that sort of issue here, but the vehicles that are being stolen, you're correct. Some are could be rental vehicles that are not being returned. Some are being out for a joyride. Some are being used and not being turned in at the appropriate return date. But there are some that are stolen, but quite a few of those get recovered as well.
Okay, so no real distinct pattern then, yeah.
To the chair, that's, yeah, no distinct pattern.
Okay, just a couple other questions. One's on property crime. So on page 35, different property crimes are discussed, and I thought you might have some comments to make about any initiatives that have been undertaken, particularly with regard to shoplifting. That's been in the news lately, but also with other property crimes, B&Es, because you can see on the bar graph, Richmond has crept up a little bit higher than perhaps we'd like to see it. So I know that you've been busy on different projects and initiatives, so maybe you could just tell us what you've been doing on that front.
Through the chair to Councillor Hobbs. With respect to retail theft, you know, this is an issue that's impacting all the communities beyond Richmond. And last year we implemented, you know, both proactive and reactive initiatives in dealing with retail theft. Proactive is the engagement of not only our community engagement team, property crime unit, but also our volunteers engaging with businesses, conducting business outreach, educating our businesses how they can not only implement measures to prevent and deter and reduce the incidence of thefts that occur at their businesses, but also how they can assist the police in not only apprehending these individuals, but also how they can collect the evidence which can assist us with charges and prosecution. Last year, our fiscal year starts from April 1st to March 31st. So for the fiscal year, we implemented the boost and bust operations similar to what other communities do. We started with four boost and bust operations. And then seeing that the trends continued going upwards with retail theft, those boost and busts were increased to eight, and now we'll be doing 12 of those. The fiscal year that ended this year, We arrested, now this is in addition to what our bike patrol, what frontline policing and others do on a day-to-day basis when it comes to retail theft, but specifically to boost and bust, 59 individuals were arrested, and over a dozen of them had warrants outstanding for their arrest, as well as they were in breach of their conditions. About 43, or about 72% of these individuals were from outside Richmond. And then the rest, about 28%, they were local. So those are some of the initiatives. Just recently, you know, we have identified those areas, the Richmond Mall and other businesses that are being targeted frequently. Our volunteers have been engaged. There is, we are utilizing social media. You know, I mean, we are encouraging the businesses to make sure that it's upsetting, it's frustrating for them, and I understand. But my appeal to our businesses is that, you know, continue to contact the police, mm-hmm. and, you know, we'll respond. And if we are busy, tied up with something else, secure the evidence and whatever information that you can for us, and we'll follow up on that. And our ultimate objective is to hold these individuals responsible who are committing these thefts and put them through the judicial process.
Yeah, thanks. Like Councillor Heed was mentioning in another topic area, it's important that we do establish, you know, a reputation, credibility, and it's good that you're working hard on that. My last question through the chair is just about the traffic section and commercial vehicles in particular. You know, there's been a lot of things happen with commercial vehicles, from running into, roadways and different accidents. And I just wondered if you could comment on the level of enforcement that your commercial vehicle inspectors might be, or officers might be doing with inspectors.
Through the chair to Councillor Hobbs, our road safety is one of our priorities. Our officers have conducted a number of safety initiative inspections with CVSE inspectors in the past, and we have and will continue to do that throughout the spring and summer, actually throughout the year, and there are a number of my officers who are, as we speak, are receiving a training on CVSE. It's a little unique area, because you're dealing with commercial vehicles, air brakes, and other, you know, the mechanical aspects of that enforcement that you need to be trained and educated on. So I have three officers who will be finishing their training, and then we will be setting up with our CVSE partners and targeting those strategic locations where, you know, we are receiving a lot of the complaints, and conducting CVSE. I know in the past when we have done that, it has not only resulted in fines, but it has resulted in identifying mechanical defects, and we don't want these, you know, big machines that have the potential to cause significant damage and harm and destruction to be operating on the road. So we'll be doing quite a few of those operations this year.
Yeah, good to know. And just one last comment. Yeah, when you're at the BC Chiefs of Police Association meetings, the idea of having trucks with a lower speed limit on every single highway, not just the odd one, I think that'd be great, because I get tired of them passing me.
Yes.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Councillor Galanders.
Thank you, through the chair. Thank you for the report. On CS34, I just want to make a comment, a question about the robberies. So for the last few months, normally the robberies we've seen is been reported as mainly youth, perhaps with bear spray and retaliation and things like this. But this one being 6 out of 8 are, sounds like, with the more sophisticated, with the online marketplace heists, and then the purse snatchings are concerning. Were there any injuries or anything reported with the purse, with any of the online and purse snatchings?
Through the chair to Councillor Galanders, no injuries, luckily, but that is a concern. You know, whether it's online marketplace arrangements where two individuals meet. We did have a couple incidents where the victim was pepper sprayed and the perpetrator stole the goods and took off, and so that was classified as a robbery. But the purse snatchings, you know, this is it's an element of surprise and person. There's a potential of, you know, individuals getting getting hurt. So we have our general investigation section. They're working on it, and they have you know, taken conduct of all of the purse snatching. So hopefully we'll make some headways. But yeah, so to answer your earlier question, no injuries were reported.
That's good to hear. There is a program, is there not, that the RCMP are involved in where people can use a service to make the online meetup safer with marketplace transactions?
To the chair, to Council Glanders, that's a program that we have launched here in Richmond, Safe Sale Exchange Program, and I really encourage our community to utilize that program. And the feedback that I've been receiving from our folks is that people are coming to our detachment, to the front counter, where we have CCTV cameras. There's front counter staff is present. We have a police officer also working in the front counter. So it just creates that sense of safety and mm-hmm. and sense of ease for individuals to, you know, conduct. But the fraudsters are very clever, and the public needs to be extremely cautious in no matter what and where they engage in any sort of transaction.
Yes. One more question through the chair. Also on the shoplifting, CS 35, 149 shoplifting thefts, the 28% increase, 46% from last year. It is concerning. I know that you've been doing a lot, and I do recall your big program that you did a few months ago, and it was reported in the news just how successful you were in arresting a lot of individuals. So I can assume that this particular month of February, we weren't doing as much in, like, that program wasn't active. I was just clarifying.
To the chair, to Councillor Glanders, you are correct. The schedule operation in February, we were unable to launch that, so we ended up doing two boost and bus operations in the month of March.
Oh, but, two in March, good. Yeah. And yeah, it's a bit frustrating. You know, I was in the London Drugs, and I witnessed somebody with a huge tote bag just putting curling irons and slippers and just loading up their bag. And I went and told the store manager, and I said, this person's got a whole bag full of stuff. And then they're like, oh, yeah. And they just let them walk out the door. And I just thought, this is crazy. You know, they used to have security guards, and they would, you know, go out and apprehend the person and hold them there till the police came and at least scare people, you know. And it just seems like they've lost the will to do anything. So I'm glad that you're educating the store or helping to empower the store owners to know that you are there and you do want to work on this.
Through the chair to Councillor Glanders, if I may make one more comment, is, you know, there are certain businesses and we are engaged at the corporate level with them. And we want to make sure that, you know, from the loss prevention officer to reporting it to the police. And, you know, there are certain businesses, they're willing to accept the loss of those items, but we want to make sure that we hold individuals accountable. You know, there are a few businesses that were experiencing a significant increase in theft, but with our teams working with them, going through theft prevention strategies, hiring an extra security guard, I have seen improvement in those businesses where the number of reported incidents have come down, but then it pops up somewhere else. So we are continuously working on that.
Oh, totally. And just to follow up, when an individual is arrested for shoplifting, are they taken down and detained like 24 hours until they get a court date and whatnot?
To the chair, to Council Glanders, theft, this is considered a theft under offense, which is theft under 5,000, and that's the category is classified in. And the individuals who are arrested, they are not taken to the detachment because there are certain things that we need to establish to release an individual, and one is the identity, and the second is the person will appear in court. Once that criteria is established, the person is released right on the scene on what's called a UTA, undertaking to appear. That piece of document also allows the police officer to place conditions on the individual. There are certain level of conditions that we can put. And one is in shoplifting cases, it's a no-go condition. You know, you cannot go to that particular store. And if the individual is found committing the same offense, and then they could be charged with the breach of those conditions. But it's a UTA, they are released to go to a court at a later date while the police gathers the evidence and submits a report to Crown Counsel for charge approval. And then the individual ends up going to court.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor McNulty.
Yeah, thanks very much, a great report. I'm not gonna repeat a lot of good things that have been said already today, but I do wanna make a couple of points from my point of view, first of all. And I'm on my hobby horse. I'm even contrary people with the DARE program, I think we do a very, very fine job with that, and that's all we really have. But I think a reminder needs to be done at grade 9 and 10 level as well. I come from I've been through a school district that where we had liaison police officers, and I hope we're getting them in there. And we also had drug counselors in 18 schools, and related the elementary school, and they were in there. And I guess my point here is, and through the liaison committee as well with the board, if we don't get to the parents of the kids who go into school, we're in a losing battle. You know, we've got to get that information across. Many of the parents don't know what the kids have done in school today. They say, "Ask what he had done in school today." I don't know. I've been there and done that. And I think we have mandatory drug education in schools, contrary to some people's point of view. It may not be what you think, it may be in coursework or whatever, but it's there, and the opportunity is there. I guess I'm pushing that, and again, it's not our jurisdiction, but together, working with the school board, I'd like us to see having liaison officers assigned to a school, and I spent this afternoon with RAS finding out what they do, and they're in the schools 8 or 9 times per year, and it depends on what the principal decides and whether they're invited in or not. They have to be invited in, you know, and to me it's late. I was hoping, and on the liaison police officers, with regard to positive tickets. A number of years ago, before these people were on council, we had what we call positive tickets. We gave the police officers, they had a pass for a skate or a swim or a milkshake or whatever, going out into the ball court or around the school after school during lunch hour, whatever. Do we have those positive tickets now? And are they given out when an officer sees something happening or just even touching base with a kid to reach out?
To the chair,
you
to
got some in your hand.
Yes, to the chair, to Council McNulty. I carry the positive tickets with me, and these were handed to me from our youth coordinator. And I myself had handed some of these out, you know, when I'm out there and you see a child wearing a helmet or they are crossing the intersection with the proper walk sign there. So these are the tickets. There's a barcode here. They can scan and it gives you entry to a number of places, rec center and aquatics and whatnot, pitch and putt. Yeah. Where they can use the one-time drop-in fee. So yes, we still utilize them.
Okay, well, keep handing them out to those that don't have helmets.
Yes,
you bet. And riding these scooters go 40K an hour. I passed one this morning. I tried to keep up to them. It was 45 on my pedometer going across to South Arm this morning. I couldn't believe it. 45. Now, maybe my car's old and doesn't work, but anyhow, keep up the good work, and obviously, if funds are required, that would be something that I would be wanting to put into our budget to make sure that we have that. So that takes care of the RAS and positive ticket. I did want to say kudos to the volunteers and the engagement of the volunteers out there. I think that needs to get back to detachment and others working with the officers. The fact that you know, whether it be Speedwatch or whatever it is. Thank you very much to each and every one of my, to me, it's extremely important. I did want to follow up with the other, Andy and others on shoplifting. You know, that report that we saw in the Asian market, the grocery store, if you watched it very closely, it was interesting. Many people didn't probably see the little lady there putting stuff in her shopping bag and walking out. You got to watch it very closely or miss it. And who was shoplifting from whom? Very, very interesting. And I'm wondering, have we become a society of cameras? Are we going to have cameras down every row now in every store like this one? He comes out in the interview. I think, Andy, you're referring to it. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to help me. Really, what he was saying, please help. I don't know what to do. And so I guess I saw the document we have in our paper in here, and it's great. But maybe we have to go one step further. Shoplifting is not going to go down, given society where it is today. It's going to go up. So what are we going to suggest to the business association, the Chamber of Commerce, or whatever, that, you know, work together to try to minimize theft at a retail level?
Yes, through the chair to Councillor McNulty, you are absolutely correct. This is an issue. The crime is just because of social environment and you know, the some of the challenges individuals are facing, and then on top of that, it's organized crime element as well. As I have stated in the past, that there are groups or individuals who will steal items from here and then they're being sold elsewhere. But you know, just going back to the Empire Superstore there, you know, we were engaged right away as soon as the concerns that came to our attention, and our community engagement team and our members have been our volunteers, our bike patrol. So we are engaged with the business, every business, they have to be vigilant. I know it can be frustrating because you're seeing a repeat of offenses happening, but we all need to remain vigilant and call the police, and it's our job to arrest and put them through the court system through charges and you know, in cases whether it's restorative justice or, you know, give them support, counseling, what they need, you know, we'll utilize all of those means in addressing this issue.
Good. Well, thank you for that. Just two quick things. Kudos to the bike patrol. I'd like to see them out there. And yes, they can stay up on Alderbridge behind the partitions there and the few bushes that are there. I love to see them there. They pick up people. Just one thing, and I mean, it's not you, but it's trucks on 6th Road. Number 6th Road is supposed to be a gross vehicle weight, about a 5-ton. A lot of trucks going down there. I'm not sure if it's an RCMP issue or is others, but Mr. Granato or whatever. I hear from the farmers along the way all the time, these big trucks come down there and they don't belong there. They're rat racing through Richmond to get down to the tunnel, and that, and I don't know what we can do about it. Trucking is a major industry, but you know, I'd rather have education than hit them with a fine every time, but I think we need to do it in speed as well, because 6th Road is a very poor road to start with on Pete, and it's a bell-shaped curve on the thing. You could go into the, heaven forbid, if we get somebody into the east side, they're going to drown. You won't get out of there in time. So just as a safety, I don't know, Mark or whoever, we can take a point of view, because I think Cash brought it up earlier about trucks.
Yes,
whatever you can do.
Yeah, Councillor McNulty, I've been on the road. It's very narrow and risky. But we'll make sure from police perspective, at least my road safety unit is aware. So whether it's education or enforcement, we'll make sure that we are out there.
Yeah, thank you, and keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Councillor Day.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair, and thank you for the report. Every time I read it, I learn so much, so thanks for all the detail. On page 39, you mentioned in your report that there's a youth section and that there were 66 visits to high schools, 105 visits to elementary schools, and then through the DARE program, 326 elementary classes. I think those numbers are amazing. Can you tell us about how that program's going?
To the chair, to Councillor Day, we have some of the most committed, dedicated, and professional police officers who are assigned to our youth section, and on a daily basis, they are engaged at our schools, whether it's elementary or secondary level. And then we also have an officer who's assigned as a DARE to the DARE program, and that officer, with the support of the youth section officers, they are continuously delivering DARE lectures to our grade 4, 5, and 6 students.
You know, I think we can be really proud of this. I saw in the news that the Victoria mayor was asking the RCMP to be allowed back in the schools because of the gang activity. And we even had a Richmond City Councilor take a petition to Victoria asking to have education in the schools. But I think we're way ahead of the curveball from what I read in the report. Like, we're way ahead in terms of what we're doing here in Richmond to try to educate the youth and prevent them from A, taking drugs, and B, getting into gangs. So I please send our sincerest thanks to the police officers and bylaw officers that have worked so hard to keep our youth safe. And then it brought me to the next thing. I noticed that the hate crimes are way, way, way down from 21 in 2020 to 0 so far in 2024. And I remember the posters, and it said, "Hate has no place." And then you did another one to stop crime, property crime, which was, "You etch it, we catch it." I thought that was a very good one. And I wonder if we couldn't do another poster program, "No to drugs, yes to life," something like that, that would send a positive message that don't go down there, you know? Like, I've got a cousin who's 65 years old and living in an old age home because he fried his brain. So they don't have to have that kind of life. So what do you think about having that kind of program?
Absolutely, through the chair, to Councillor Day. I'm always open to new ways and new strategies, and whatever we can do to, you know, save lives, I'll definitely look into this and explore what we can do.
Well, I'm really proud of what we've accomplished here in Richmond, and I can't thank you enough. And on page 36, we apparently have the second lowest violent crime in Metro Vancouver. Coquitlam keeps beating us. We're going to have to do something about that. But on that list is not Vancouver. And given that Surrey is almost the size of Vancouver, do you think maybe on that graph on page 36 we should add Vancouver?
To the chair, to Councillor Day, I will take it back to our analyst. I know those stats are available. I will look into that.
Okay, I'll leave it with you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I have just a couple comments. I was in a meeting with the Chamber of Commerce this morning, and certainly the challenge of shoplifting came up, and there were some staggering numbers about losses coming from some of our local businesses, and a real desire from some of our businesses, the Chamber, to get together and have some deep conversations of what needs to happen. And I think, you know, probably the school board needs to be involved in that as well. And I think probably our kids need to understand that there are repercussions for shoplifting. And I think most of the time you're dealing with prolific offenders, but those aren't the people that are eventually going to be trying to get certain kinds of jobs or travel out of the country or take on certain roles in government or in the community or something like this. And so having a criminal record follow them around is going to be really deleterious to their future. And because the average person who is caught for shoplifting doesn't just get turned back out on the street. Is that correct?
To the chair, yes.
Okay. And I think that information needs to happen because I think people see, you know, shoplifters being turned out and, you know, they're sure they can't go there anymore, but they're sort of a different group of people. It's not necessarily the future that we imagine for ourselves and our kids that that they'll be in that category. We'd like them to be able to get certain jobs and to be eligible for different things as they grow up. Okay. Thank you. And one of the other ones that came up too this morning was that the reason the 7-Eleven had closed in Steveston was because of the rampant shoplifting. And a lot of it was coming out of the high schools. So it is our kids that are also the problem. So, okay, we have a motion. Thanks. All in favor? Thank you. And the 2024-25 Richmond RCMP Detachment Annual Performance Plan, Community Priorities. That's you too, I think.
Thank you. Madam Chair, last year we had established four priorities that form part of our annual performance plan. And those priorities were organized crime, property crime, road safety, and vulnerable persons. So the request this year is again to carry on with those priorities, those four priorities, because they are the major categories. These are the priorities that align with not only Richmond RCMP's strategic plan, but they also align with City of Richmond's community safety priorities. And each of these categories, they have all the subcategories that we report on here. So these were the best four that that are proposed here for the next year, for this current year. And yeah, if there's any questions, I'm open to answer any questions.
Councillor Hobbs?
Sure, not so much a question as a comment on the property crime one. And you brought it up yourself. And it's the messaging, and it's more than just Richmond, so maybe again it's, you know, BC Chiefs of Police where you can talk about it, but it's about corporate messaging when it comes to theft and shoplifting, because if we have too many large corporate companies sending out the signal that it's okay because we can afford it, well, that kills not just medium-sized business, but small business, because not everybody can afford to just take it. So they have a duty as a good corporate citizen not to send that message out and not to allow people to do that, and to put the resources in and the working partnerships established with police and others to make sure that that isn't the message going out to organized thieves or random thieves, because that's completely unacceptable for large corporations to send that message out because they might be able to afford it and they just don't want to deal with it. So I think that's something police and other stakeholders can take to chambers of commerce and different corporate citizens when we're talking to them, because it's, I think, fundamentally flawed, and we've seen it not work in other jurisdictions. So I'm glad that you mentioned it, and it's tough to deal with when you have people and organizations that aren't pulling their weight and helping out, because it's not just a policing issue. So thanks.
Thank you.
Councillor Heed.
Yes, it's certainly not just a policing issue, but it's not our job to police the big corporations. They're all about profit, and that's it. So I'm not sure what we can do as a local government other than make a comment about they should be, but I'm not saying that even the police, given my experience, can tell the corporations certainly what to do. And you know, we don't hold any hammer over them whatsoever. So at the end of the day, you've got to understand there's some people that are going to play on the side of poverty, drug addiction, mental health that are involved in this. I don't necessarily agree that our youth are problematic in the shoplifting. Yes, we have to certainly steer our youth in the right direction, whether it's delinquency of any sort, or substance abuse, or even their own mental health. And it was great to see the federal government put some money aside for mental health for our youth. But boy, we've got to have a real clear understanding of what's going on before we try and take an extreme position on something. And you know, you can, London Drugs is a key
partner, their head offices, I think, are still here in Richmond, just off of Steveston Highway. And, you know, they miscommunicated that they were going to shut down their store on Granville Street. So, you know, it's a delicate issue here, and I just don't think it's something that we want to take on at our level. I think there's certain things we can do. There's certain things that we expect our police agencies within our jurisdiction to do, but I don't necessarily agree that we have to be in using Madam Chair's thing, Big Brother, all the time and watching over the corporations. Thank you.
If I may, through the chair to Councillor Hobbs and Councillor Heath, we continue to engage with those enterprises and we are working to ensure that you know, we have their cooperation, and in that, you know, they are working with us and supporting the police in doing what we need to do, which is to arrest and prosecute those individuals.
Thank you. Do we have a motion on the floor?
Sure.
All in favor? Thank you. OAC briefing.
Madam Chair, I have just one item on the list. This pertains to our volunteers here in Richmond. I am just always so pleased and humbled to work with our volunteers. We have individuals from their teens. My daughter is part of the volunteer team here, to citizens who are in their 70s and 80s. We have about 119 plus of these individuals, and the list keeps growing. And they are really integral part of our community. They come out and they volunteer their time in crime prevention, crime deterrence, community safety initiatives. Every year we honor them, I honor them, and we did that this year with a volunteer dinner. And next week is the Volunteer Appreciation Week. So I think it's just appropriate to play a video that was compiled by RME Randall Worland, which showcases the great work that our volunteers do. And this is the video that was played during the Volunteer Appreciation Dinner in January and of this year. So it's my pleasure to play this for you all.
Another speeder. Hey, slow down. Hey, Randall, can you do anything about all the speeding in Richmond?
I wish. I'm just a coordinator. Fan, is there something you can do about all the speeding in Richmond?
I wish. I'm just a constable of a Richmond Road Safety Unit. I'm doing my best, but situation like this, we need the A-team.
The A-team?
In 2016, an elite speed watch unit was formed of passionate citizens who wanted drivers to stop speeding in the city of Richmond. These men, from different walks of life, came together to slow down aggressive drivers and bring peace to the streets. Today, still wanted by neighborhoods in Richmond, they thrive as volunteers of fortune. If you have a road safety problem, if no one else can help you, and if you can find them, maybe you can get the A-Team.
Thank you, and that's it from me.
Thank you. Any other questions? Councillor Heed?
Yes, I just want to make a comment. We were shared this by Ms. Akiem, the e-scooter skills challenge. I think this is great. You know, I said to you last year about the individual that put together that video. This is fantastic because, you know, as mentioned, we talk about it in the public works and transportation. We talk about it in community safety. And, you know, my pet peeve is the helmet thing. But I think this is absolutely great. If we want to talk about something where we're keeping up with what the problems are, this is good. So, well done.
Thank you. And I saw your PSA with that on Twitter or whatever it's called, X, today.
Yes. Thank you. Yes.
Any other questions? Thank you. Do we have a manager's report today? No. We have a motion to adjourn. We are adjourned. Did we want to go into close on some of those things, or next time, another time?